A colleague and historian, Andrew Hersher, recently observed that the decaying factories, abandoned houses, and empty lots of post-industrial cities like Detroit and Buffalo are catnip for artists today. Thus, Detroit attracts transient artists like photographer Andrew Moore, whom you see here, who is a Piranesi with a camera, whose large format color photographs of Detroit's decline are exhibited and collected as art, but also excoriated as ruined porn. Other artists and entrepreneurs like the New Yorker Robert Elms are now relocating permanently to Detroit. Elms, a founder of an alternative performance and visual arts space in Williamsburg, Brooklyn, 20 years ago, will create new venues for artists, musicians, and performers in the six Detroit buildings that you see here, which he recently purchased for the cost of a small New York City apartment. Almost half a century ago, Gordon Mata Clark was drawn to another post-industrial frontier like Detroit. In the 1960s and 1970s, he and artists Laurie Anderson, Tricia Brown, Philip Glass, and others became urban pioneers and homesteaders in the moribund district of 19th century cast iron factory lofts and storefronts south of Houston Street in New York City. Here they lived and worked at day jobs like waitressing and also building construction, but they also created art and they founded their own exhibition and performance spaces in what would become known as SoHo, the acronym for South Houston Street. Best known for his cuts into the architectural and urban fabric, Mata Clark's medium, here he is at 112 Green Street, another institution that he founded. These interventions into the very fabric of urban ruin and deindustrialization. And here are two of his more complex and challenging building cuts, conical intersects, which you saw in the previous slide, and then this wonderful 1977, actually he did not live to see this completed, Broke Office, he also called it. He loved punning as well. So drawing on his archives here at the Canadian Center for Architecture, I want to shift the discourse surrounding his work from what Gwendolyn Owens and Philip Ersprung once called, quote, a kind of splendid isolation, which, and Wendy may disagree with me, I take to mean the emphasis on the sheer visual beauty, the complex geometries of his building interventions, and the theoretical sophistication of his ideas. And here in the Mata Clark archives, I was delighted to find a smoking gun in terms of his relationship with French theorists in the unlikely form of a lunch receipt from La Bonne Soupe, where he had lunch with a situationist in 1976. I'm very curious to know who it was. Again, the kind of splendid isolation of works like Bingo, which he did in 1974. These are three surviving sections from nine cuts that he did in a Niagara Falls house, and again, detached, displaced from their environment. So building on Sharon Zukin and Rosalind Deutsch's studies of artists' communities, urban change, and rights to the city, I will try and weave my lecture this evening around these sites of deindustrialization and urban renewal where he worked. Mata Clark's projects in such urban fringes as the outer boroughs of New York, you see in, he's in the South Bronx, also working in the suburbs of New Jersey, and for Bingo, also in upstate New York, as well as in major centers like Manhattan and Paris. And I think these projects demonstrate just how pervasive urban renewal projects through destroying, through tearing down buildings were during the post-war years, both in North America and also in Europe. In 1976, he wrote that his approach was, quote, to make do with whatever is possible while stretching the notion of the possible. I saw raw urban fabric in a raw, abandoned state, transforming unusual spaces and structures into revitalized areas. So what I'm going to do is to focus on Bingo and his proposed Lower East Side project in New York City. I think these are perhaps less well known than some of his more spectacular building cuts. And I want to propose that they suggest a different direction, and for him, a new direction in his work in the last few years of his life. While Mata Clark had once described his building cuts, quote, as performance-based, but not intended for other people to watch, it's very much for a private audience of one, myself, end quote. In these last years of his life, he began to engage with other and different kinds of people at the Bingo Project in upstate New York. And this led, along with some other events in his life, to a desire to create more enduring projects working with and for community residents. And his focus will be on the Lower East Side in New York City. Now, what can these tales of hope and also tales of caution that we see embedded in Mata Clark's projects tell us about urban development and revitalization today, especially when the so-called creative class, so beloved of the sociologist and now urban consultant Richard Florida, are seen as absolutely vital to these undertakings and projects? And also because urban ruin and devastation are found not only in shrinking cities that are contracting, also a condition of exploding cities as well. So cities that are as different as Buffalo and Mumbai will try and bring into some kind of a relationship with each other. So what can Mata Clark tell us about other ways of designing structures, building communities, and conserving heritage? And is his work a model for projects that have both a critical and aesthetic edge, but are also community-based and involve working with members of the community? For as Mata Clark explained in an undated interview, perhaps from 1976, quote, "I do not work in architecture in the conventional sense. I work in buildings. Although I talk about spatial complexity and employ terms within the common architectural vocabulary, my concerns are non-utilitarian, non-economic, nor do I labor under any of the restraints that are inherent in the architectural profession," end quote. Now, as you probably know, Mata Clark was the son of Roberto Mata, a surrealist painter, and Anne Clark, a costume designer, hence the name Mata Clark. He grew up in avant-garde circles of European and North American art. His godmother was the wife of Duchamp. Although Mata himself had left architecture for painting, he encouraged his son Gordon to study architecture at Cornell. And Mata Clark, however, while he was at Cornell in the 1960s, resisted the all-consuming nature of studio culture. He took courses in sculpture, Asian art history, French literature, city planning, urban sociology, and political theory. His required classes in architectural history were in the Italian Renaissance and early European modernism that Colin Rowe and many of my colleagues at Cornell still see as foundational for both architectural theory and design studio. Now, the idyllic and isolated upstate New York campus was especially in turmoil during the years when Mata Clark was a student there. There were racist cross burnings, anti-Vietnam War protests, and the first armed takeover of an American college building, as you see here. And the African American students who occupied the building purposely planned it on the weekend of a parents' weekend, so they got maximum coverage. And again, this went, in the parlance of today, viral. It was the kind of publicity Cornell did not want globally. A very sad story of guns still on campus, but here they were more symbolic violence than actual violence. The other upheaval that took place at Cornell in 1969 was the Earth Art exhibit when the avant-garde came to upstate New York. And this really did set Mata Clark on his path as an architect and as a sculptor, as he often described himself. He and other students assisted artists like Robert Smithson and Dennis Oppenheim, and you see, again, the boys of Earth Art who are kind of lined up here, Smithson on the far right-hand side, and Oppenheim, the second in from the left, and the gentleman in the suit is Tom Levitt, who was the director of the University Art Museum at that time. Dennis Oppenheim and several of the other Earth artists worked with real men's tools, chisels, shovels, pickaxes, and chainsaws that Mata Clark would later use in his work. And you see, Wendy, we think that Gordon participated in this BB Lake ice cut of Dennis Oppenheim, which was perilously close to the falls at Cornell. They were actually given a ticket by the campus police. I think they're very proud of that. And this is Robert Smithson's work, The Mirror Trail and Mirror Displacement, where using mirrors and earth and rock salt, he created, again, from the galleries of the University Museum out to a salt mine that was on the adjoining Finger Lake. A critical of the rarefied white spaces of museums and galleries, the Earth artists created artworks in and from natural, but also industrial or post-industrial sites. And then they displaced remnants or representations of these works back into exhibition spaces, as Mata Clark would soon do. Smithson's theories of entropy and collapse and his projects like Monuments of Passaic, New Jersey, which was a tour of the deindustrializing landscape there, documented in a photo essay, especially inspired the young Mata Clark. However, he chose to work in the built fabric of everyday life, its tenements, factories, and suburban homes, rather than the remote locations, particularly in the American West, favored by Smithson and especially Michael Heiser for their projects. As Ned Smith, who worked with Mata Clark in the South Bronx, later said, quote, "Heiser cut through natural earth and rock. Gordon cut through the urban landscape," end quote. Now, Ithaca was only a dress rehearsal for the violence, racial strife, social unrest, and economic collapse that roiled New York City when Mata Clark lived and worked there between 1969 and 1978. The flight of factory jobs and the white middle class to the surrounding suburbs and then Sunbelt cities like Houston and Los Angeles left the hollowed-out economy and disintegrating neighborhoods for new Hispanic and African-American rivals to New York in search of greater opportunity. As you can see in this slide, a section of the West Side Highway collapsed around 14th Street, so the city was literally collapsing. It was teetering on the brink of financial crisis. This infamous Daily News headline of then-President Gerald Ford, who refused to provide funds to bail New York out of its bankruptcy. In 1977, when I was a graduate student at Columbia, there was a blackout, and unfortunately, there was widespread rioting in that summer that led to $1 billion worth of property damage and over 3,700 arrests for arson, rioting, and looting. Beginning in the early 60s, tenants and landlords torched derelict buildings throughout the five boroughs for public assistance and insurance payments, respectively. Planned destruction became so routine that the commuters walking through the staged demolition of McKim, Mead, and White's monumental Pennsylvania station seemed oblivious to the havoc above their heads. In this photograph from Peter Moore, who did an entire series on the destruction of Pennsylvania Station. And Moore was also a colleague and friend of Mata Clark's as well. He was the photographer of the downtown art scene. Government urban renewal agencies undertook wholesale destruction of residential and commercial areas like the 60 acres bulldozed in Lower Manhattan that you saw in the previous image by Danny Lyon, another photographer who knew Gordon Mata Clark. You can also see it in this photograph of the World Trade Center under construction. These projects in downtown Manhattan left over 170,000 people homeless, and they were primarily poor and working class Puerto Ricans and African Americans. They were the collateral damage that we see in this photograph, this homeless man who is passed out or sleeping in the foreground of the World Trade Center towers under construction. Mata Clark claimed kinship with the homeless and displaced. In a 1974 interview, he said, "As a native New Yorker, my sense of the city as home runs deep, being full of an honest regard for its state and the quality of life available there." he felt that he had been displaced from the LaGuardia Place home where he had grown up in the expansion plans for NYU. And so again, a very extensive demolition program surrounded that area as well. So home, community, and homelessness were preoccupations of Mata Clark in his work. For the 1971 project Firewood that you see here, Mata Clark plastered together a small wall from the tin cans, rubbish, and waste paper he collected around the Brooklyn Bridge anchorage, which at that time, not like the Dumbo of today down underneath the Brooklyn Manhattan overpass, it was a kind of Mad Max landscape of garbage, feral dogs, abandoned and burned out cars, gang members, and the homeless. Mata Clark hoped that his work on this garbage wall, and you see a sketch from the CCA archives here where he's working out this idea of a kind of wireframe and then filling it and plastering together, but he hoped that it would inspire the homeless who were encamped around the anchorage of the bridge to turn the garbage into something more sturdy than their rather fragile cardboard shelters. He also, for this event, and it was part of a larger exhibition that took place around the Brooklyn anchorage of a number of artists, he also roasted a pig and handed out hundreds of, we hope, fully cooked ham sandwiches. Jane Crawford, a filmmaker herself and Gordon Mata Clark's partner and wife, wrote in 2004, quote, being one step away from homelessness himself, Gordon strongly identified with them, that is the homeless. All of Gordon's sculptural and food projects were designed to initiate a dialogue with the community, end quote. Now, one of his first cuttings was Bronx Floors, Thresholds of 1972. And again, he was a punster, both in terms of language, but also a visual punster as well. Along with Splitting, the work that I showed you previously from New Jersey, and Bingo from upstate New York, these were his first major building cuts. Mata Clark could cut these buildings because they were abandoned and awaiting demolition for these widespread urban renewal programs. To fund his work, he tirelessly networked and corresponded with city bureaucrats, government agencies, and even power tool companies. And he said, you know, I use power tools. I can, you know, become a spokesperson and representative for your company. So the CCA archives are filled with these letters. They're quite fascinating. But he also sought more traditional sources for funding an artistic project. He corresponded with dealers, collectors, museums, and foundations in North America and also in Europe. So he was a wonderful networker. In that sense, he wasn't really the rebel. I mean, he knew how to work the system. He was very good at it. And he was particularly successful at winning government grants and fellowships from the relatively new National Endowment for the Arts and the New York State Council for the Arts, which was actually the first state council of the arts in the United States and served as the model for the National Endowment for the Arts. And compared to today's situation in the United States, funding for the arts, particularly for avant-garde visual and performing arts, seems incredibly rich during this period of the 1970s. And again, he knew how to exploit it. Both of these agencies, both at the state and national level, set up special funding programs for political reasons, in part, also the best of intentions, to encourage artists like Gordon Mata Clark to work in small towns beyond the major cities, and also to train and employ disadvantaged youths. And of course, that becomes the basis for his involvement in the Bingo Project in upstate New York, and also his interest in developing connections with the Lower East Side community in New York City. However, the Bronx tenement that he cut into for Bronx Floors, that you see the images for here, was strictly a case of illegal breaking and entering. Again, it was another condemned and abandoned building that was going to be bulldozed. As he said, quote, the wild dogs, the junkies, and I used these spaces to work out some life problems. In my case, having no socially acceptable place to work. Menacing roaming gangs and law authorities, as well as simply cutting into these dilapidated structures, made working with Gordon, Manfred Heck, one of his frequent assistants, quote, always exciting. There was always a good chance of getting killed when you worked with Gordon. That's what I liked. So again, danger. And you know, this is also the period of Taxi Driver, and this notion of violence is imminent in the city as well. And here, Hollis Alpert, who was Anne Clark, Gordon Mother's second husband, is a very eminent film critic who championed a lot of these young filmmakers who were dealing with issues of violence in the city. Splitting the house in Inglewood, New Jersey, was a little easier and a little less nerve-wracking than working in the South Bronx. This was because the husband of his dealer, Holly Solomon, gave Mata Clark a house he owned in an African-American neighborhood. But it also was to be torn down, again, for an urban renewal program in suburban New Jersey. Nevertheless, remaining residents there, as in the South Bronx, viewed these white artists with suspicion and often hostility. In 1974, Mata Clark told a reporter that the neighbors often accused him and his assistants of using their electricity for their power tools and stealing materials like valuable copper tubing from the houses. Apart from himself and these sometimes hostile neighbors, his friends, fellow artist, his dealer Solomon, and a few art critics were there during the process of these building cuts and also when they were completed. But Holly Solomon and others often recalled their own anxiety and trepidation, for instance, as they navigated through Day's End, a 1975 project in an abandoned Chelsea warehouse where Mata Clark had made huge cuts through the floor to the river waters below. Because these projects were ephemeral and hazardous, sometimes difficult to get an audience for them, and they not everybody wanted to go to the urban frontier or wilderness of the South Bronx. So film, photography, photo collage, and actually preserving fragments of the cut buildings became important for purposes of documentation, but also for broadcasting his work to a broader audience and also for sale as well. He did not mind exhibiting and selling these depictions and even built fragments. Interesting here that he also provided his collectors with a certificate of authenticity, just in case there were rogue building cutters out there, I guess. He felt as long as the integrity of the cut project was not compromised by either the gallery's exhibition of the fragments or their exhibition of the photographs, screening of the films, and exhibiting of the photo collages. However, it's interesting that Mata Clark claimed to have sustained more extensive injuries in taking the three surviving fragments of the Bingo Project from upstate New York to John Gibson's gallery in Soho than he did from actually making the building cuts on site in Niagara Falls. Now, an invitation to participate in the first Art Park exhibition in Lewiston, New York, was the first building cut where Mata Clark had generous funding, again, primarily from the state of New York. He had the support of a staff associated with Art Park. Also, the local community in terms of students and local business people contributed time and materials. And he also had a potentially larger audience as well. Opened in 1974, Art Park was a program of visual and performing arts in an upstate New York park overlooking the gorge along the U.S.-Canadian border. So this is in the area of Niagara Falls and the Niagara River. Art Park's purpose was to make contemporary art more accessible and less confrontational by integrating artists, their methods, and their works into the leisure time activities of everyday people who would come to a state park. Required to be in residence, the invited artists were charged to create only temporary works in what was intended to be an ongoing residency program. So each summer there was a new class of Art Park artists working there. Almost all the artists engaged with the Niagara Falls, the gorge, or the river, but also the bridge spanning the river. Here you see Nancy Holt's Hydra head. These were large concrete pipes, that were put into the ground. They were filled with water. She was inspired by a legend of the Seneca Indians that the waters were really the eyes of the world, and the idea was that they would be reflected in the stars, would be reflected in these pools that had been embedded along the Niagara River. And you can see the bridge in the background that also became a staging area for many artists' works. It was quite a variegated landscape in the park. There were old abandoned railway tunnels, and as you can see here in the upper image, there was a landfill and a toxic chemical dump. And many artists chose to work in those areas. Art Park was very good in its invitation to many women artists. We saw in the 1969 Cornell Earth Art Show that it was real. It was really an all-male contingent that was there, but there were many artists, and Agnes Dennis was another one of the prominent women artists, and she actually planted rice on a part of the toxic dump, and it came up this very strange red, apparently. And this was an area of Love Canal because of contamination. The Hooker Chemical Company had been dumping chemicals there, and they had warned real estate developers not to build suburban homes there, but they persisted anyway, and the homes had to be evacuated. So it was an area that was highly polluted, and again, the environmental concerns of these artists very much came to the foreground here. Now, Mutta Clark was a bit perverse, however. Instead of working in the art park, as almost all the other artists did, he chose a site in the city of Niagara Falls. The image of himself that he provided for the art park publication, the first one in 1974, shows him sitting on a pile of rubble beside a tenement building with what looks like the modern towers of Co-op City in the Bronx behind him. Maybe some of you can prove or disprove that for me. Juxtaposed with this photograph of himself were the images of the Bingo Project in Niagara Falls. So I think he's in the pages of this publication, he's creating a dialogue in between these urban renewal programs that are taking place both in smaller cities like Niagara Falls, but also in major metropolitan centers like New York City as well. Now, the house that he chose for the building cuts in Niagara Falls was a red house. It had once been a three-family home and then later had been converted into a beauty parlor, so it had had many incarnations. Visible in this color photograph are the grain elevators to the right behind it. You can see a bit of the letters for shredded wheat, the cereal that was manufactured in Niagara Falls beginning in the late 19th century. And those of you who are familiar with the shredded wheat cereal, you know that its logo included the power of Niagara Falls. So I guess it was a kind of super-powered cereal as well. Cheap and abundant hydroelectric power from Niagara Falls had brought industries like the National Biscuit Company, Nabisco, to the small cities of Western New York by the late 19th century. By the 1960s and 1970s, Niagara Falls, however, like New York City, was losing its manufacturing base to plant closings and relocations. Famous as a tourist destination, of course, for honeymooners in particular, the city was also losing this lucrative source of income. A new parkway built by Robert Moses routed traffic away from the downtown area of Niagara Falls and eliminated pedestrian access to Niagara Falls. Mutta Clark's house that was awaiting demolition was just behind the Philip Johnson and John Berge New Conference and Civic Center in Niagara Falls, which was an urban renewal project that was meant to revive the city's economy. It was somewhat disdainfully referred to as the Quonset Hut. Because of its enormous size and the cost overruns associated with the Conference and Civic Center, it never lived up to its potential, and it became really a millstone around the neck of the city authorities and residents. Now, the Canadian Niagara Falls, which of course always had the best views of the falls, created a very carefully integrated economic development plan that was coordinated at all levels of government. And that laid the foundations for a new casino, new hotels, and retail centers that blossomed in the 1990s. And that area has continued to prosper. While on the New York side of Niagara Falls, there is still decline. There have been ill-advised development programs, mismanagement, and a lack of this integrated and coordinated economic planning at the local, the state, and the national level. And of course, New York Niagara Falls has very much been hurt by the Niagara Falls on the other side of the border in Canada. And so the Canadians have done much better. Now what I want to try and do, and Pallavi has helped me with this, is to show some film clips from Dingo. This is a silent film. Mata Clark was a great fan of silent films, particularly the comedies of Keaton and Chaplin. And I love this letter board that he uses for the intertitle. It again reminds me of somebody placing the markers on a bingo card. I'm going to try and not do what so many of my colleagues in film studies do, is to tell you and explain and interpret what you're going to see and then show you the film clip. So maybe we can have discussion afterwards, your own impressions. I will say, I love that, you know, the moment when you think you're going to cut down to the house and you realize it's only a photograph of the house. So I think he's taking a kind of visual poke at the abstract diagrams, the nine-square grid that were very much favored as formalist devices at Cornell and other schools of architecture as well. Mata Clark said that, you know, what he wanted to do in building was to have physical confrontation, that he was not interested in more abstract approaches to architecture, which of course is what Colin Rowe, his Mathematics of the Ideal Villa, very much promoted at Cornell, which Mata Clark referred to as one's entering into an academy where you got the word, and it was almost like going into the monastery. It was a bit of a monastery high above Cayuga's waters in Cornell with Colin as the Pope. So I think it's interesting that you move from that photographic depiction of the house into the actual cutting process of these nine sections from the northern facade, and then they're lowering down to the ground. And so you're very much aware of the materiality of the house and the camera angles and the framing, and then the physical effort in the lowering that took place of eight of the nine sections. According to Wendy and records here at the CCA, he shot a lot of footage. He had people helping him. Oftentimes when you visited Mata Clark on the site, you were given a camera to document. So it looks like it was a fairly high ratio of what he shot to what was edited down into the film itself. In the interest of time, I won't show you the other two clips from Bingo. So that was just maybe a teaser, so we can move on. As I said, he cut the house's facade into nine sections, each one measuring 9 feet wide by 5 feet tall. One was destroyed by the bulldozer that came to the site as part of the urban renewal program. That was the one in the very center, which is often in this nine-square grid problem that we still give to students at Cornell, is the most problematic one. What do you do with that central square, in a way? Three then went to New York City for exhibition at the John Gibson Gallery, and there were another five. And those were trucked to the Art Park site. He had to have, I think, some engagement with Art Park. And they were dumped along the gorge trail. Before, however, they were either taken to New York or to the Art Park site, they were carefully lowered to the ground, as you saw. They were coated in plaster. They were sheeted in plastic. A local reporter said they were a bit like a murder victim with the plastic around them, and then were crated for transport. And Mata Clark wrote in the 1974 Art Park catalog that he judiciously dumped these five sections, and with the forces of natural reclamation, these building parts became part of the eternally mysterious remnants of an elaborate celebration of abandonment. So again, performance and celebration were very much a part of his art. Bingo, during the process when he was working on it, had a title of Been Gone by Ninth. And as Mata Clark described it, it was about an undoing of a building where there are many aspects of the social condition against which I'm gesturing to open a state of enclosure which had been preconditioned not only by physical necessity but by an industry that profligates, in his words, suburban and urban boxes as a context for ensuring a passive, isolated consumer, a virtually captive audience. In a rather informative newspaper interview with the local Niagara Falls reporter, he was quoted as saying he wasn't sure that Bingo should be called a work of art. However, he was very certain it was about the process of changing buildings and changing the way people see them. It's also unclear if Mata Clark had any interactions with the Art Park visitors, as the artists were required to do. Bingo did, however, draw some curious local residents during the 10 days that he and his crew worked on cutting the nine sections. While some came to watch, others reminisced about the people who had lived in the Erie Avenue house. Still, others admired the building materials, and they were quoted as saying, that was a time when 2x4s were still really 2x4s. Mata Clark was also quite surprised by just how pleasant his experience in Niagara Falls had been compared to working in the Bronx and New Jersey. Officials from the local urban renewal agency, he noted, were actually helpful in assisting him to locate a building for the cuts. And the demolition crew members were somewhat taken by the novelty of his idea for Bingo, and I would say they probably also admired the 12-hour days that he and his assistants put in. Thus, they postponed bulldozing the house to give him more time to safely remove all the eight rectangular cuts. Now, Mata Clark had helped create communities and audiences through 112 Green Street and Food. Robert Longo and Cindy Sherman, then students at Buffalo State College, both worked at Art Park, as did other local residents and students. Inspired by the artists there and 112 Green Street and other New York alternative art spaces like Artist Space, they and the artists, somewhat older, Charles Clough, founded Hall Walls, a Buffalo Center for the Visual Arts and Performing Arts, in late 1974, so several months after the first summer at Art Park. Buffalo then, and still is today, a once great industrial and commercial center that is in decline and, again, is losing population. The opening of the St. Lawrence Seaway in the late 1950s had rendered Buffalo obsolete as a center for commerce and transshipment between the Great Lakes and the Atlantic Ocean. Its good-paying union jobs in the steel, automotive, and grain industries were being eliminated or moving elsewhere by the 1970s, and a similar story of so many of these post-industrial cities. Buffalo was and still is, as I said, losing populations to the suburbs and Sunbelt cities. However, at this time, it had growing cultural capital. Buffalo State College and the University of Buffalo, which were both part of an ambitious expansion program of higher education in New York under Governor Nelson Rockefeller, had professional programs in art, music, literature, and media studies, the first such media studies program in the United States. And these programs drew students and faculty interested in the arts from New York City and elsewhere, like Sherman and Longo, as well as upstate New York. As Robert Longo said about Hall Walls, it was the training ground. The city was ready. The timing was right. The building was there. And all the people were smart and hungry. Hall Walls, like 112 Green Street, an artist space, took over an old industrial building, in this case, an ice packing warehouse in Buffalo's West Side neighborhood. It was a community in transition, as very established white ethnic communities fled to the suburbs, and then Hispanics, Native Americans, African Americans, and soon Vietnamese moved in seeking opportunities that were actually beginning to dwindle, again, because of this post-industrialization process that was taking place in Buffalo. Hall Walls had studios and galleries on the corridor walls, hence the name Hall Walls, as well as performance spaces and living quarters for the artist. Again, extensive state and federal funds supported ambitious exhibition, lecture, and residency programs that brought avant-garde artists like Robert Irwin, Laurie Anderson, Chris Burden, and Robert Creeley to Hall Walls in Buffalo. In 1978, there was an earth art exhibit that included Mata Clark's early work on a New York City pier. Now, these younger Buffalo artists like Cindy Sherman and Robert Longo had grown up on film, television, and popular culture. Unlike Mata Clark's generation, who had made art from the city and landscape, these young artists, soon to be dubbed the picture generation, began to focus on film, video, and photography as media to explore the construction of identity and meaning, as you see in the Sherman piece, ideas of the construct of feminine identity, and Longo, in his way, masculine identity as well. This particular cast piece that he made, The Seven Seals for the Missouri Breaks, was based on an Arthur Penn film, The Missouri Breaks, that was released at the same time. It was a Western that was set in the Missouri Breaks, which were these gorges that harbored thieves in them. Many people feel that Buffalo and Hall Walls, thus, were ground zero for the postmodernism that would engulf the art world in the 1980s and 1990s. This was a time, by the late 70s, when government funding was slashed for all programs under President Ronald Reagan, and right-wing ideologues declared war on avant-garde artists and spaces. So this generation really had to become entrepreneurial to survive either through university teaching or mastering the art market. And Sherman and Longo in particular proved to be a mistress and a master of that. They had very, very early critical and commercial success. They decided to leave Hall Walls in the late 1970s again, as this government funding was beginning to draw up. This was also a time when New York's economy under Mayor Ed Koch was beginning to rebound as well. He took a very tough stance on policing in New York City, and he also gave real estate developers their relatively unfettered hand. And of course, the art market also benefited from this as well. Mata Clark, and other artists had gained acclaim for their work. And of course, they had brought attention and interest to the spaces of the galleries, the performance areas, and the restaurants they had homesteaded in what was now becoming known as Soho. So real estate developers now began to understand artists were an inexpensive way to outsource redevelopment of moribund industrial areas and wastelands. Desperate to revive their urban economies, these local, state, and federal officials and agencies gave private investors virtually free rein, with few or almost no requirements to serve broader and disadvantaged communities. The irony was that the artists, this sort of advanced group of urban redevelopment who had pioneered, developed these spaces, and made them an interest, they would soon be displaced as well. Although he made increasingly daring and complex building cuts with Conical Intersect and Office Baroque, Mata Clark now wanted to begin working with communities to create more useful and enduring projects. I think his experiences at Bingo and the Art Park with a different kind of audience for his building cuts must have been encouraging. He was also inspired by a group of young Italian communists who occupied a Milan factory building. And their demands were to turn it into a community service center instead of its being raised for high-end commercial development. And here you see a photograph of it, and on it is a drawing by Mata Clark, and this was a project for a triumphal arch for workers. The tragic death of his troubled twin brother in 1976, he wrote, was another reason that he now wanted to work with communities in need. Thus, he began working with Puerto Rican and Latin American activists and residents on New York's Lower East Side. Mata Clark won a New York State Council of the Arts grant to work with LOSAIDA, Lower East Side Organization for Political Action, Cultural Pride, and Economic Development. He wrote a friend that he was very excited by the Lower East Side's neighborhood, its lived-in streets, its homes, and its healthy dose of fantasy, which he must have felt was disappearing in a now rapidly gentrifying Soho. The community gardens that were carefully tended by Lower East Side residents, and Liz Christie was one of the founders of the community garden movement there, also struck a resonant chord with him, because this is where residents grew and cooked food, they made music, they played dominoes, and they danced. And so all of this impressed him with a sense of community that he had helped to create in the early 70s in Soho. What he planned to do with his Lower East Side project was to train and work with the youth there to rehabilitate a large-scale derelict building into a job training and environmental resource center that was owned and run by the community. Working on the center, which would become, quote, an informal school of the streets, he wrote, these young Lower East Siders would gain, he wrote, quote, practical information about how buildings are made and the real possibility of transforming their spaces. And for his part, he would adapt his work, quote, to no longer be concerned with just personal and metaphoric treatment of the site, but finally to be responsive to the express will of its occupants, end quote. Mata Clark put his ideas for this Lower East Side project only into letters and grant applications. He died in 1978 at the age of 35 from cancer. But his experiences at Art Park and with Bingo and his proposals for the Lower East Side have had a surprising afterlife. In 1995, when the city threatened to reclaim the Lower East Side community gardens, which of course were on public, albeit abandoned property, Bette Midler, the divine Miss M, a downtown artist who had crossed over into mainstream success in the entertainment world, bought the gardens up in order to protect them. This then led her to found the New York Restoration Project. This is one of their gardens in Willis Avenue community in the South Bronx, where Gordon Mata Clark had worked. So their mission is to work with marginalized communities on education and job training in urban agriculture, reforestation, and garden design and construction. Hallwalls survived the departure of its picture generation founders, and it began opening itself up to a more diverse community through its exhibitions, performances, and educational programs. Hallwalls artist Dennis Mayer, who is a Cornell architecture graduate like Mata Clark, he's now a professor of architecture at Buffalo, the university there. He, after graduating from Cornell, moved to Buffalo and first supported himself through the all too prevalent work of demolishing abandoned and foreclosed buildings. He bought a dilapidated house, you see the interior here, and began restoring it through sweaters-like assemblages of objects and cast-off materials that Dennis finds in his journeys throughout Buffalo, very similar to what Mata Clark did as well, kind of trawling, he once wrote, from First Avenue to 125th Street. Mayer has also opened the house up through Mata Clark building cuts, which you can see here, in the floors, ceilings, and walls. He is now at work turning an adjacent property into a center for residency programs for not only artists from Buffalo and elsewhere, but also local carpenters, plumbers, and electricians. The latter began by making art on the subject of home from the materials of their trades in works that Dennis Mayer commissioned from them for an exhibition at Buffalo's Albright Knox Gallery in 2013. Mata Clark's ideas and aesthetics, I would argue, have some traction even in exploding cities like Mumbai, as well as shrinking cities like Buffalo. The city's Indian entrepreneurs built a modern industrial center for textiles using the cotton of the country's colonial extractive economy in the second half of the 19th century. These textile mills drew men and women workers from across India to what was then called Bombay. A militant trade unionism and vibrant working class culture developed in what became known as the city's cathedrals of cotton for their smokestacks. By the 1980s and 1990s, the city, now called Mumbai, was undergoing a catastrophic deindustrialization too. Mill owners relocated and automated their manufacturing. They were also determined to break the union, so there was a very, very bitter strike that lasted for almost 10 years. Hundreds of thousands of people lost their jobs. While the city of Mumbai was deindustrializing, the Indian government was forced to open up its centralized and highly regulated economy to private investment and entrepreneurship, both from home and abroad. This was to avert financial collapse. Mumbai, like New York City, survived deindustrialization because it was also a center for the now burgeoning service economies of media, finance, and real estate. I want to show you this work, the mills and the chawls, and those the workers' entitlement, tenement-like housing, were torn down, as you can see this upper register here, for shopping malls, office towers, and luxury condominium, this incredibly valuable land in central Mumbai. There are now only a few ruins of the city's once great industrial engine and heritage. And it's here that artist Meera Devi Dalyal shows us, like Mata Clark, that there are opportunities and potentials within the reuse of these ruins. They can become spaces for urban wilderness, cultivation, and community. So let me show you a clip from her film, A Level Playing Field. Which is set in one of these urban ruins of the Milllands. Absolutely incredible to me how the city has changed, even in the 17 years that I've been going there, this amazingly overheated real estate market. I know a colleague of mine calls these new towers weapons of mass construction. And I think her point is that, you know, this in a city that is really starved for public space and recreational space, these young men have colonized and taken over the ruins of this textile mill. What is being offered to them, you see in the window bays, is a much more passive culture of consuming cricket rather than playing cricket. And I just have one more. I know I'm a little bit over, but I am closing. Today, the so-called creative classes of not only young artists and architects, but also IT professionals and business entrepreneurs flock to exploding cities like New York and Mumbai, of course. The more adventuresome, and perhaps the less well-established, see the potential of affordable living and working spaces, as Mata Clark did, in shrinking post-industrial cities like Detroit and perhaps soon Buffalo. So in this upper register on the left-hand side, this was an article from 2011 in the New York Times showing some young white professionals who were on the rooftop of a Detroit skyscraper. And at that time, Detroit municipal government, in combination with some private foundation, was actually giving them cash incentives to relocate to Detroit. So again, they were seen as so vital to kick-starting the economy. I will say that, again, I think it's extremely interesting that the aesthetic of ruin and decay that Mata Clark and his colleagues at Food and 112th Street, Green Street, were involved with, now has become so pervasive and popularized that recently a high-end line of cosmetics was introduced called Urban Decay, with eyeshadows in the shades of Factory, Blackout, Liar, and Mugshot. So I don't know if any of these young women are wearing that on the Detroit rooftops or not. But I would say that Mata Clark's ability to infuse urban projects with meaning and metaphor without sacrificing a critical edge and responsiveness to the needs and aspirations of diverse communities, like this gentleman, Chuck Brooks, photographed by Andrew Moore, one of the few photographs where he actually has a person you can see, who's a Detroit homesteader, must be a way for the creative class to engage with these communities, both in shrinking and also exploding cities around the world. Thank you.
Mary and I have talked about the fact that there is an art park archive sort of in pieces and a person who's worked on it. And we're both eager to get to Buffalo and sort of look together at some of these pieces. I'll say two more things. One of the things to remember that when we find these oral histories is the problem of the imperfect memories that everyone has. It's in the era, I mean, people are older. There was a lot of mind-altering substances involved, so people don't necessarily remember things accurately. So when sometimes you find two or three reports and they're completely contradictory. And the third thing, and I think this is really interesting in seeing where you go into bingo, because I'm so glad to see you sort of taking this on. In many cases, he was planning as he went. He wasn't sort of, this is what I'll do and that's what I'll do over and over to make it clear. But then when he would present it to people, he would very often present it as if it was exactly as he planned. One of the things he would say in interviews is, it went exactly as I planned. And one of the great things about the CCA archive is you can see, no, things never went exactly as planned. But if you find one source, very often you'll find that one source where he'll have an interview and he'll say it went exactly as planned.
Now, I think that's a really interesting point, because it returns us to the idea that his work is a performance and he's a performer. I mean, he was closely allied with Trisha Brown and Carol Gooden. He was a dancer. He was very, very physical. And so I think the notion of the art as a performance, but his also performing after the fact, becomes extremely important as well. And apart from the mind-altering substances, I think, you know, the way we all edit our memories, and I was a gallery girl in the mid to late 1970s in Soho, and I remember going to Food. It was like a canteen, and I try to remember, I mean, you know, what did I say to him? Did I say anything to him? You know, what did I observe, et cetera, long before I ever thought that I would look on him.
The entire story, but wasn't it also the case with the Milan project, where in fact there was a lot of tension with the workers, where they actually were happy with the project, and I forget what exactly transpired, but it was a There was some tension with the community that he was working with. They weren't quite happy.
That's good to know. I have to admit, I haven't come across that in the archives. It's not a project I've delved into, so maybe you'll help me.
I read it, but in fact, it may be in the archives. And then the other thing I simply wanted to mention is that as you talk about some of the follow-up that happens, or not follow-up, but some of the developments that happen after he dies, it's interesting that the last project, Office Baroque, then gets saved by the art community and turned into a museum, which I think is really a nice legacy also.
They tried, but it didn't work.
They tried. I thought, no. They created a fund.
They created a fund.
And unfortunately, they failed, but they really tried to make it happen.
Who else? Sorry, just a quick observation.
Yes, go ahead.
What you described though there about the chaos that seemed that he, in retrospect, says everything went to plan, sounds to me to fit exactly like confusion guided by purpose.
Yes.
That is, yeah. The teleology was satisfied because it was ruled by chaos.
Right.
Well, again, I think, in a way, that's what he still has to offer us as we look at these sides of decay, of ruin, a sense of confusion. Mm-hmm. And particularly when I know there's a current project in Mumbai that one of our good friends, Abba Lamba, who is an architect who specializes in preserving historic buildings, so one of the few textile mills that has miraculously survived, they want to turn into a museum, both for the city of Mumbai, but also for the textile industry and textile design. And yet, I think Abba, under pressure from city officials, it's become more of like a shopping mall for fashion in a way. And that's what I like about this Indian Artists Project, that the potential for the ruin to serve as a kind of framework for urban wilderness. Now, that's also problematic. One of the mills in the background that you see there is the Shakti Mills, where there's a horrific gang rape that took place. And in fact, the artist was quoted as saying that she could no longer work in this area because of the danger associated with these sites. But I mean, I think it's another way of thinking about how we make a future for the past, that it's not all about returning it to a complete and idealized moment in the past, that it can take on a different life and a different character. And I think that's what I really try and teach my conservation students about Gordon Mata Clark, because I think it's very important to think about the historic buildings that have come down to us in perhaps different kinds of ways.
Yeah. I just want to make a comment, Mary. The basic attitude towards conservation is not to restore buildings to an ideal moment. In fact, that's absolutely against the conventions. Yeah.
It's true, but I have to say it is long lived at places like Cornell. I'm sorry to say. Perhaps that's what I'm responding to. So I hope there are more enlightened centers in some way.
Well, that's incredible. It's a basic convention. What is it? The sentence is what you should offer.
Exactly. No, that's a very good point. And I think the greatest challenge for those working in this organization
is
that's right. But I still find perhaps I don't know it's the kind of students that we get at Cornell, but this is what they want to do, and they are very averse to interacting with architects. They see the architect as the enemy.
This is not a good talk.
Sorry, maybe I'm revealing our dirty laundry.
By the way, I think it was a fascinating talk.
Oh, thank you.
More comments? Or yes.
Please. It was a fascinating talk. And can you tell us why you became interested in Mata Clark?
I'm sorry?
Why Mata Clark?
Why I'm interested in Mata Clark?
Yes.
Well, again, I have to reveal a bit about my 30 years at Cornell. I have to say that I feel part of my role there is to acquaint my students with a kind of counter legacy to Peter Eisenman and Richard Meyer, that there is another Cornell. And I was absolutely delighted when Jacques Herzog, who taught at Cornell in the 1980s, came and gave a lecture 2 years ago. And he was very adamant. And he and Peter were going to engage in a dialogue with each other. He was saying, Mata Clark is the real legacy of Cornell, and that's what we should honor. And then it was very interesting to hear him talk about his early days and how, at least then, he was very politically engaged in the work and also working across disciplinary boundaries with artists as well. So I have tried to teach courses and develop conferences and projects to introduce my students to this. And I didn't bring any of the student work in, but one of my students did an absolutely fantastic project where he started out by collecting garbage in New York City and making pinhole cameras. And then he would go to parks and other community sites and he would perch the cameras on a trash bin or sometimes on the street on a dumpster. And he would begin to make these wonderful photographs And it was also about engaging with the community as well, because people thought, what are you doing? And so the student's, former student's name is Darius Wu, and for his thesis project from Aristotle, he decided to create a garbage wall along the Tiber River, interested in the archaeology of Rome's garbage. And so for his thesis project, again taking gabion crates, very much like Gordon Monteclark, he built a beautiful garbage wall. I have to admit his kind of curation of the garbage was extremely selective, because there were lots, well, of course it's probably true, and there were lots of wonderful glass bottles that the light was filtered through as well. And so it became a kind of public promenade and running track along the river. And the idea was that it would also sprout vegetation as well. So I was absolutely delighted to see how he had taken some of Monteclark's ideas and really brought them back into the architectural realm and environmental realms in a very interesting way. So I think students see enormous potential in Gordon Monteclark's work because it was so varied. And they do, Wendy has participated in some of these events, they really respond.
Well, and I was just going to say a compliment to you, because what I've seen with the work that you've done and the conference that you did, that you have been able to change sort of the dialogue and get people thinking about this alternate history, which also involves architects talking to artists, talking to the museum, which I also spent time at Cornell, where, and it's like they're different continents. There aren't bridges, except for people like you, like Matt Clark, who've made this effort to make this come together and to see other ways to do things. So I think you've really accomplished something.
Well, because of people like you, and also I have to say, Jane Crawford has been incredibly generous and supportive. She has spent so much time with my students going over their projects, responding to them, and she is just amazing. And she has been so generous and so supportive, you know, to scholars, to students. Yeah, she is amazing. So we have to thank Jane.
Anyone else that wants to say something? Yeah, Greg.
I have a question about places of display. Since you kind of touched on the importance of earth art and also his version of that. But I guess one of the things I was really thinking about in your talk was how the deindustrialized building, this is the period when it starts to become a new form for the museum. If we're thinking about earlier, like Dia Beacon, but upwards to Tate Modern to nowadays, artists prefer these sorts of buildings to the White Cube.
I think that's such an interesting point, because it shows in these spaces like 112 Green Street, which is an artist-run space. It was where they worked, where they exhibited, where this community came together, that again, kind of like Bette Miller, has crossed over into the mainstream in terms of the museum as an institution. So I think that's a really fascinating point to develop. So that's a great comment, thank you. And again, it's interesting that, you know, it would be Herzog with the Tate Modern. And I was really struck by his comment about Gordon Monteclark, and talked a little bit with him after the lecture. And he said, no, he said, I don't care about this theory. I mean, Peter is absolutely wrong that we should be concentrating on that. I found that quite encouraging. And again, having real architectural implications as well. I mean, it's interesting to me that, although he said, you know, I don't conventionally practice architecture, I work in buildings and I'm interested in the physicality, which I think was a reaction to the abstractionism and the theoreticism at Cornell under Colin Rowe. That, I think, is what students, particularly in the digital age, are very hungry for as well. And then these traces of past lives of a building, kind of the character and the laminations in a building, are extremely important. I mean, that, I think, makes the building less static, which is another thing he was interested in. The building had a more dynamic living presence in some way. That's an excellent point.
One of the things that sort of struck me in distinction to the sort of earth artists was this notion of erosion, I guess, and weathering, and the sort of scope of the performance. So in many of these pieces, actually the performance precedes this final product, and the product itself has a certain very specific shelf life, and it's sort of, there's no opportunity for erosion, and that aspect of the project is sort of non-performative. And I was a little bit curious if there were considerations in other projects specifically about this idea of weathering and an idea of a life cycle which actually began with the intervention but was intended to continue over a much longer period of decay or reconstitution.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it's interesting, particularly vis-a-vis those garbage walls that in his sketchbooks he's very interested in, and in fact he envisions them as rather more monumental structures. I mean, I can't remember, my notes weren't so good, if he actually calls it a garbage cathedral, or there's was simply a structure that reminded me of a cathedral with its vaults that was built out of garbage. So again, how those would change and transform over time would be interesting to consider. I mean, it was interesting to me, I was reading an interview that he did about 1976, and it hadn't struck me before, but he said he went back to the site of splitting before the building was torn down. And he very much liked the fact that the garden had continued to grow, and in fact it was overgrown, and that the apple tree next to it was bearing fruit, and some of the fruit had also fallen to the ground and was rotting. So these various stages. So as far as I know, he never documented that, and he never brought it in or brought it back into these other spaces. I think also the idea that it was very important to work in film. If you think about a project like Day's End, which he also called the Sun Temple, and the cuts that had to be positioned so the light could be filtered in. So, I mean, the kind of transition over the course of the day with the sun, you know, rising in the east and setting in the west, and this was on the Chelsea Piers. So, I mean, I think there's kind of an absorption of the building into different spaces of time and weather, in a sense.
I mean, the landfill in particular seems like a sort of interesting intersection in a way of this waste process and a sort of earth, sort of like erosion process. And so, a little bit curious whether the remnants of Bingo, which were just, you know, essentially became their own new landfill, were intended to, I don't know, intended to sort of like incite another kind of erosion process.
Well, and I also think, I mean, there were a number of artists who were interested in these ideas at Art Park because of the contamination of the sites there. It was a little later, I think, that the scandal of Love Canal broke. I think that was maybe 76 or 78. So, I mean, they knew it was a highly toxic site. And of course, this was a generation that had initiated the first Earth Day as well. And I would say that Smithson, of course, was very interested in these ideas of erosion and collapse. I mean, what happened to Spiral Jetty? It would be interesting to know, had he lived, what his reaction would have been to you know, the waters rising, the waters receding in some way. So I think... And Smithson, he also did this project called a partially collapsed building. I took that out because I had too many slides. So this whole notion of entropy. And he also did a dumping project as well, which looks very similar to the landfill dumping that was taking place at Art Park as well. So I think many of these artists were really interested in working in Art Park because of the kind of variegated nature of the landscape and that it raised these environmental issues for them.
Thanks, Mary. Thanks, particularly a lot of really interesting intersections between Madame Clark and other artists who, particularly in the 70s, since the 70s, have become, I guess, considered part of other genealogies of practice, sort of distinct communities of practice from those that Madame Clark's associated with. Which makes me wonder how you are, what kind of critical frameworks you now might be developing in this sort of shift that you're sort of doing with the way that you're interpreting some of the projects. Mm-hmm. So particularly thinking about the way that, you know, Amanda Clark's work is valued within, say, fairly conventional, well understood circuits of art theory, art criticism, but you seem to be shifting some of this work towards other circuits, you know, related to socially engaged or activist art practices or relational art practices, that where, you know, other kinds of critical frameworks have been developed and debated often fiercely, you know, kind of in comparison to the sort of critical frameworks that have previously been applied to work like Clark. So I'm wondering how you're navigating that.
Well, I have to say, even though I was the professor of architectural theory, as a graduate student, I came from a very under-theorized generation, so it's not my first move, in a sense. I tend to immerse myself in the material, and particularly the visual material, and to try and treat that with the same care as the textual material. I absolutely agree with you. I find, you know, again, I think those are all really important discussions that are going on, particularly in the context of the art projects that are both local and then outside to Detroit. I think Andrew Hersher has written some very interesting work, and I think his point that oftentimes there's an inverse relationship between the kind of criticality of this public art and how much it engages the community. That they seem actually to be at odds. That Andrew cites this one project, and I forget the name of this. It's an artist-based community that wants to go into immigrant communities, I think in a suburb or an outlying area of Detroit. And they're very well intentioned, but they do have people painting plywood butterflies and planting them on their lawns.
It's a great free piece. Three-part piece by Martha Rosler for Eflux that is exactly along those lines.
So I think that's the interesting thing. I mean, there are certain tensions in Mata Clark's work, and I think the point about, I think, you know, audience theory and reception theory is important here, and moving it beyond the art world in some way, this kind of, I don't know, it's a transformation, but a kind of evolving process in his thinking. I mean, and what he experienced, I mean, very immediately in terms of the landscape of New York City that he saw tremendously transformed during his lifetime as well. So, I'm not sure that answered your question.
Well, my question was actually just about the center, because I find fascinating that this, you know, art world, because this is where it's supposed to appreciate, that it transforms itself as a reception of theory relating to sociological things. And you said this has already been discussed in literature.
Well, I don't think so much the emphasis on the audience and sort of reception theory, a broader audience from Mata Clark. So I think that's an area that needs work. I think it's more inside baseball, perhaps, in terms of the artistic community, in some sense. I think it's, and these discourses that are evolving, I mean, from 1968, in Europe, and all of these events that are taking place. That lunch that he had with the Situationist is very
intriguing. Yeah, well, but you have to place it within the art world.
Oh, absolutely. And I think it's also interesting that, you know, his community building and institution building begins within the art community. I mean, that he learns the lessons there from Food and 112 Green Street, as others did as well. And there are some wonderful comments, I guess, in the script the shooting script, which is quite extensive for food, where he makes a comment that it was a kind of crossover place, and I remember where there were still locals in there, where there were still some light manufacturing had completely disappeared, and they would come to food. And I think he makes a comment that they really like the food and they like the prices, but they really wish that the cooks and waitresses and waiters would cut their hair. So I mean, it's interesting, these points of intersection, but that I think your point is very well taken, that it does begin, it's a notion of a community for and by artists in some way, as a counterweight to the established galleries and the museums.